He was only the prologue, so the whole Tour de France lies ahead, and I'm fine. It was just a setback for me, but not for my hopes for these first days. I think the rest of this tour will be very much better.
Preparing for today's first stage, Pedro is surrounded by his teammates, and you can bet they make sure he starts on time today.
Conventional wisdom holds that the prologue, which comprises only 10 minutes of a race that takes almost 90 hours to run, is virtually meaningless. But yesterday's prologue, thanks to Pedro Delgado, was another matter. And I think also if you look closely at the results, you will see some facts that are extremely encouraging to American hopes in this year's tour. Greg LeMond, for example, was looking for a morale-boosting ride, and he got that with his fourth place. And for Andy Hampston, he had the satisfaction not only of his own good performance, but of the solid performance of the team upon which he will be counting so much in today's team time trials and, of course, over the next 3 weeks. That team is the only American-sponsored team in the race, 7-Eleven. When the riders of today's 7-Eleven team were little boys, before they fell in love with the world of cycling, and before any of them might have wondered how riding a bike could possibly pay the rent when they grew up, a chain of stores was growing up as fast as they were, and the stores sold a drink called a Slurpee.
Excuse me. Hi, I'm a Butlin Marty. Yeah, you make
that into puffs, aren't you? Slurpees, just when you need them, only at 7-Eleven, the sign of the times.
Team Slurpee, as it was affectionately known, was born in 1980. By 1984, they were ready for the Olympics, and six team riders won medals. After the Olympics, 7-Eleven turned pro, leaving home to race in the big time against the Europeans. The team's ascent was spectacular, and it provided a showcase for new American talent. Maturing along with the team was a young rider named Andy Hampston. And with Hampston, 7-Eleven reached new heights last year with victory in the Tour of Italy. Hampston in Italy was brilliant, particularly on this day when he mastered the Gavia Pass in brutal conditions. It was a ride which earned Hampston and 7-Eleven the respect of the European cycling community. Eager to display its form in front of the folks at home, the team entered the Tour de Trump this spring, winning with Norway's Dag Otto Lorentzen, while Hampston rested for the big one ahead, the Tour de France. Labey, Switzerland. The team is based in the heart of Europe, but it has a distinctly non-European training philosophy, less regimented. Wives are allowed to roam with their husbands. The atmosphere is relaxed and fun. The name on the frame of the bike is that of the man who supplied the bike, Eddie Merckx, the Cannibal. Lately, the Cannibal has developed a soft spot for the team and occasionally rides with them.
As soon as we learned about the sport 10, 15 years ago, he was the man. And here he is just kind of hanging out with us in Switzerland, going training. And he's doing a lot, helping me and the other riders with positioning and, you know, really fine-tuning our bicycles.
I have a lot of experience now, and so I think it's good for the guys too that if I come over and to pump them up for the last days.
What the team must do in the tour is to help Hampston in every way possible. Formations are practiced which shelter him from the wind, and strategies are planned to wear down his rivals. He is their star, and they know it. But when the team is off duty, it's another matter. Everyone's a star, or, if you're Roy Nickman on this day, a birthday boy. The team has come a long way in 9 years, and a lot of Slurpees have been sold to make it all possible. The kids who like to race bikes have grown up into young men for whom fun means not only riding, but riding to win.
Like 7-Eleven, its team has now stretched across many borders. Six countries are represented in the nine cyclists on the squad. This Slurpee has an international flavor. And today, stage one is on their mind. In a moment, why the Tour de France is what it is.
They said we never...
The tour is made up of a lot more than just the sights and sounds of France. There is such a diversity of origin, of personality, and of opinion. To understand what all the excitement is about, you have to go back, way back. 1989 marks the bicentennial of the French Revolution, which has affected the lives of everyone in this country in countless ways. It is as large a part of France's heritage as the rare juices of Bordeaux and Burgundy, as large a part of the spirit of France as the idea of a newspaper publisher by the name of Henri de Grange in 1903. And quickly the world met characters like Maurice Guérin, who smoked on his way to winning the first tour. The tour moved forward, but for a few exceptions. Twice it was halted by World War, and once the cyclists went on strike for a rest. But the flavor and the color of the tour always made headlines. The newspaper of De Grange, which sponsored the race, was printed on yellow paper, and in 1919 it was deemed the leader would always wear the color of choice. There are but a few whose names are synonymous with that shirt. Frenchman Louis Sambobay won three straight in the 50s, only to be bettered by Jacques Anquetil, the first to win five. He would arrogantly predict his wins. He was a Norman, and Normandy's rivalry with Brittany, centuries old, came to life again when Bernard Hinault, a Breton, tied Anquetil's mark. They called him the Badger, dangerous when cornered. Cycling's greatest name, however, came from across the border. Eddie Merckx, another five-time winner, was Belgian, and his nickname, the Cannibal. The inspiration to chase the legend and beat the French at their own game lives on. 1986, America wins its first. 1987, Stephen Roach becomes the toast of Ireland. And in 1988, Spain's Pedro Delgado shut out the French again. Mountains, some like Alpe d'Huez, as famous as the riders. First climbed in 1952, it has become nature's arena, where the Tour de France is often lost as many times as it is won. Look carefully, and you'll see broken dreams lying on the slope. Climbing Mont Ventoux in 1967, Tom Simpson, the only Englishman to wear the yellow jersey, collapsed and died. Days later, it was discovered that the only man to die in the race had amphetamines in his blood. Pedro Delgado's drug controversy last year almost gave the yellow jersey a black mark. Tragedy and triumph, personalities and the joy of the country. Its history reflects the history of France. In fact, it was decided that the final stage this year from Versailles to the Arc de Triomphe would honor the revolutionists who followed that route 200 years ago. So with stage one about to begin, Eric Breukink of the Netherlands and Panasonic wears the leader's yellow jersey. A scant 6 seconds behind him is the Parisian splendor, Laurent Fignon, looking to win his third tour. Greg LeMond is right where he wants to be so early in the race as his comeback continues. While Pedro Delgado has the most difficult job of all, almost 3 minutes to make up, but 2,025 miles to do it. 2 years since the Tour de France has crossed into Luxembourg. The third stage of the 1947 Tour was also historic because it was the first time in 44 years that an entire stage was held outside of France. Such stages are not uncommon anymore. Stage one today is 84 miles long, leaving the city south towards the border of France, then along the border of West Germany, and back to downtown. Now the picture that many see when they think of images of the Tour. The cyclists are free to grab whatever position they want. It is interesting that Pedro Delgado has decided to begin the 1989 Tour de France from the rear. Ironically, that's how he's standing, last. Symbolically, it may reflect how he feels about himself. The peloton moves out along l'Avenue de la Liberté, lined with architecture inspired by the Renaissance and modern banks inspired by something else.
Just a few kilometers after today's stage started, former Scandinavian champion Søren Lilholt attacks. Folly or bravery? Time will tell. The peloton are under the control of Eric Breukink's Panasonic team, and they seem quite disinterested. So the opportunity has been accepted. Lilholt, who is no stranger to racing, is launching a tremendous attack, and he's on his way now to building an initial lead of 2 minutes. He made an escape like this in the Paris-Nice race last year and stayed ahead for over 100 miles, longer than today's race. Most importantly, he won the Tour of Luxembourg 2 years ago, running over many of these same roads.
That's absolutely right, Sam, and Lil Holt is a lone race expert. He goes clear and he tries to hang on in to the finish. He'll be thinking here of building a good lead and staying away all the way to the finish, because today's stage, but even by Tour de France terms, is not a long way. It is possible he could get the yellow jersey.
So the peloton, the main pack of riders, moves powerfully along, comprised of one less rider than was in the group when it started. They have decided collectively that Lilleholt can be as lonely as he wants. At times, the roads were beautiful in their absence of anything except the cyclists. But every once in a while, a small group of people make their way to the roadside, and their Tour de France experience is as long as it takes the peloton to pass by. In the midst of the spirit of the peloton is Eric Brockink, wearing the leader's yellow jersey. He is among other leaders that we have met so far who have all decided not to make the move.
Well, the onus is always on the team who has the race leader in the yellow jersey to attack those who attack them. And nobody has decided to chase the leader on the road at the moment, not even Pedro Delgado, who started this race already at a disadvantage.
Among those who is happy to cruise at this particular speed is American Andy Hampstead. He didn't expect to make any loud noises in the early stages of the tour, just looking to be solid. And he looks comfortable where he is right now.
Quite clearly, Al, everybody feels that Lilleholt is not the leader of the race.
Lauren Fignon, who finished second in the prologue yesterday, stopped for a bit of a comfort break, feeling confident enough that he could make it back to the peloton. And the two-time winner of the Tour de France has been able to do just that.
Fignon looks relaxed. He has regained the confidence in himself that he lost during the time that he was injured. By contrast, Greg LeMond is still on the road to full recovery.
The saga of Greg LeMond, a story of betrayal, of tragedy, of glory, of family, and finally of faith in himself, of an American who made a big mark in a foreign land, an American who is now trying to do it once again. If you can't beat them, join them. Them in cycling for so long was the Europeans. And the American who decided to employ this old phrase for his own good was Greg LeMond. With his wife and children, his first foreign home was France, and now Belgium. He joined them. And when he won the Tour de France in 86, he beat him.
I came over here with the idea I wanted to win the Tour de France. That was a dream for me. And I think all the Europeans have that same dream. But I had to leave my country, come here, adjust a whole different mentality, a whole different culture. I believe if I was Belgian or French, I probably would already have two other Tour de France victories in my career.
The victory was embittered by a vicious rivalry with his then-teammate Bernard Hinault, who had promised support and then changed his tune.
It was so difficult with the team relations, like we didn't know who to trust, and we really felt like an island, like Greg's parents and my parents and Greg and me, and that's it. And then the whole nation of France against us.
Greg hasn't raced a stage in the Tour de France since. 9 months later, a hunting accident that left 30 shotgun pellets in his body. Later, an appendectomy. But the dream to return to prop actor in cycling once again this season have been largely unfulfilled. 27th in the Tour de Trump, 39th in the Tour of Italy. And now a different level of expectation as the Tour de France begins.
When you have an injury, especially like I had, a hunting accident, you're brought back down to zero, below even when I turned professional. And in the meantime, you have journalists and teams and the public asking you to be as good or better than you were when you were on top. within 1 year, 2 years, and that's impossible in this heart of a sport. What I'd like to do is start the Tour de France with hope of finishing it and finishing it strong. And if I can place in the top 10, I'd be very satisfied. After the last 2 years, getting to the Tour de France has been the most difficult point.
Nummer 1 er ham her, for når man i nøgen tilstand vælger at udfordre sprintere og et par politimænd på selveste Champs-Élysées.
The other riders in the peloton and the road.
Well, then Greg would be interested to know that as the peloton moves along the banks of the Moselle River, not only are they visiting some of the most important wineries in Central Europe, but a very important battle line in World War II as well. And the chase is becoming more interesting.
It is indeed, because the sleeping main peloton has allowed two more adventurers to escape. Acacio da Silva of Portugal on the Carrera team, trailed here by Roland Leclerc, the Frenchman on the Paternina team. And they're out to catch Søren Lilholt. And after a long chase, the two riders behind are about to catch Søren Lilholt, leaving the main field behind by almost 9 minutes. Now three men can work more efficiently than one.
This trio now prepares to say goodbye to the vineyards on the left and the border of West Germany on the right. It's time to head back into the city as they pass the halfway mark in stage one. The teamwork between the three, which was encouraged by some frequent shouting. De Silva, in the hat, lived in Luxembourg for 14 years, in the crew cut Lilyholt, winner of a one-day stage race here, and Leclerc of France, who just seemed to tag along with men of local knowledge at the right time. Well, pretty soon these three in the main pack will be winding their way near Luxembourg City, where they will pass some very important areas in terms of the United States and the way they have touched this part of Europe in a very important plaques in remembrance of important dates of liberty in times of war this area of the world would like to forget. The Park Hotel is such a place, and it is the backdrop of the Break 3. You cause quite a stir on the Tour de France when you break away from the peloton like this, as De Silva, Lilholt, and Leclerc have done. Look at the parade of media cars that follow them as they head toward Luxembourg City. Now, in that parade are team support cars. And from those cars, these three cyclists are getting information. Strategy. Just how far back is the peloton? Well, it's good news. For right now, the peloton passes the Park Hotel 11 minutes behind the three leaders.
Pedro Delgado, what happened to him yesterday would have unbalanced even an unemotional person, and Delgado is anything but unemotional. Overnight, he has traded the aura of defending champion for that of a guy who made an embarrassing mistake.
Winning a champion tag is sometimes easier than keeping it. And as the peloton winds through some of the prettiest landscape you'll see on this year's Tour de France, the three leaders speed on towards the finish line. The big pack seemingly not yet concerned. The Panasonic team too has refused to answer the call. They seem ready to throw away Birking's early lead. And with 30 miles to go, the pack is too far behind now to win this day.
If Brucking and his team don't seem that interested in keeping the yellow jersey and the pressure that accompanies it, there are three men who lead the race who would be more than happy to accept the honor. On the edge of the city, 3 miles to go, three men approach what they know will be a critical time, a time when the race will be decided between them, a time they may never be able to match in their lives again, if it means a chance to win a stage and also wear the yellow jersey.
Game today is lost for the pack, but Delgado on the right here in the blue on the very last climb with a mile and a half to go puts in one show of final defiance and heads the field.
Delgado has looked for opportunities to regain lost ground, but he has been unable to find them so far today. Acacio da Silva, with a burst of energy, has dropped the other two riders He has lived in several different countries, speaks four languages. He has many relatives and friends here in Luxembourg, an inspiration for him to succeed today. He often leads big races in the early stages. He won the fourth stage of the Tour last year, and as he approached the line, he raised his hands in victory too soon and was almost beaten at the last moment.
But that was only a stage victory a year ago. This time, the stage victory includes an extra prize, the yellow jersey for Acacio da Silva, who raises his arms in victory once again. And as the holder of the yellow jersey, da Silva will be the first man from Portugal to ever do so. And he is paying the price for fame in the Tour de France. The peloton made up a great deal of time, and that will make their days ahead a little easier. They will finish 4 minutes and 40 seconds behind Acacio. Note that Delgado, who looked to have thoughts of moving away from the group on his own, was not allowed to go anywhere by the other power brokers in the peloton with him. An average speed of just over 40 kilometers an hour, or about 25 miles per hour, in this stage of the Tour de France. We may hear very little from Acacio da Silva and the rest of the Tour. One bad stage and quickly fame ends. But tonight and tomorrow and all over Portugal, they will hear more of him than they ever have before. It was Brooking's yellow jersey when the day began. He is now in fourth. Greg LeMond is still in the thick of things in this Tour de France. And Pedro...